Now, over in the West, the leaders of the 31 members of the NATO alliance now meeting in the Lithuanian capital for a two-day high-stakes summit. On the agenda, Russia's aggression in Ukraine, regional security, as well as the membership bids of Sweden and Ukraine. On the eve of the summit, Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan agreed to move ahead with Sweden's bid to join the military alliance. Erdogan has stood in the path of Sweden joining NATO for more than a year now.
It has been a good day for Sweden. We haven't made any new commitments beyond what is in the trilateral memorandum, plus what we now call the bilateral security compact. No other commitments. Everything we do will be within the scope of Swedish legislation.
Sweden and Finland applied to join NATO last year, casting aside policies of military non-alignment following Russia's invasion of Ukraine. The ASEAN Foreign Ministers meeting gets underway in Indonesia. The gathering of Southeast Asia's top diplomats comes as the political turmoil in Myanmar continues and tensions in the South China Sea remain unsolved. Jakarta is hosting the meeting this year as the ASEAN's chair for 2023. Indonesia's foreign minister all but stressing regional stability and peace is the priority.
The maintenance of peace and stability in the region is our priority. It is our foundation to turn the region into the epicentrum of growth. Therefore, we must keep Southeast Asia as a region free of nuclear weapons.
As for the Philippines Foreign Affairs Chief, Secretary Enrique Manalo tweets, he joined his ASEAN counterparts during an intergovernmental meeting on human rights this Tuesday. Southern Japan takes stock of the trail of death and destruction left by torrential rains. The floods and landslides left at least 6 people dead. 3 others remain missing. The Japan Meteorological Agency has downgraded the special warnings for heavy rains, but it still urges residents to stay alert for possible landslides. Japan is the latest country to be hit by unusually heavy rain, raising new fears of the pace of climate change. Rare snowfall dusted parts of South Africa, including Johannesburg. The state weather agency said the snow was brought by cold front that hit the country late last week. Forecasters warn of potentially dangerous cold temperatures and road closures due to the cold front. Snow was last seen there in 2012. The House Makabayan bloc seeks an inquiry into that campaign video fiasco. House Deputy Minority Leader Franz Castro believes it's better to launch a probe separate from the 2024 budget deliberations since they can summon at agency DDB Philippines. Castro also says the House probe can help determine whether the state should still fund the tourism rebrand. According to Castro, the rebrand campaign costs 1.2 billion pesos. That's 37% of the tourism department's budget this year.
Pag hindi na daan ito sa House resolution discussion in the appropriate committee, hindi natin matatanong dito yung yung contractor, yung DDB. Whereas sa budget, matatanong lang natin dito yung DOT. So maganda sana kung bigyan din ng pagkakataon ng leadership ng Kongreso na maisa lang ito doon sa Committee on Tourism and Good Government and Accountability so that we can see sides or positions of both the DOT and the contractor.
Moving on, the Philippine Air Force attributes the increased presence of American air assets in the Philippines to ongoing bilateral exercises. Air Force spokesperson Colonel Consuelo Castillo says the Philippine and U.S. Air Forces opened the second iteration of COPE Thunder exercises on July 7. Over 600 Filipino air troops and their American counterparts will conduct large aircraft movement exercises in several Philippine cities. Castillo assures the public the U.S. Air Force assets are covered by diplomatic clearances. Philippine Senator Aimee Marcos earlier questioned the U.S. Air Force's increased presence in the country.
As long as they are covered by diplomatic clearances, as communicated to us by the Department of Foreign Affairs, then I think it's no threat. It went through the proper process. All those involved in training, of course, and all those under also the MDB, SEB, activities. Those are all aircraft that went through the proper process of getting the proper diplomatic clearance.
The Metro Manila Police is forming a group to pursue and apprehend former Prisons Chief Gerald Bantag and his deputy Ricardo Zulueta, who are the suspects in the murder of broadcaster Percy Lapid. Jeff Capadas joins us on the line for more. Hi, Jeff. What can you tell us?
Hi, Mimi. Good afternoon. The Philippine National Police on Tuesday said the manhunt for ex-Bucor Chief Gerald Bantag and his Deputy Security Officer Ricardo Zulueta continues. According to NCRPO Chief Police Brigadier General Jose Melenzo Nartates, aside from Bantag and Zulueta, they are pursuing all wanted persons in NCR. Yesterday, Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos said he directed the PNP to continue the hunt for Bantag and Zulueta. General Nartates acknowledged the reminder from Secretary Abalos and said they will form a group aimed at pursuing and apprehending Bantag and Zulueta.
He will be subjected to manhunt or arrest. It is a continuing one, continuing effort. Ngayon, wala pang resulta such that he will be put behind bars and answer the cases leveled against him. Ang operatiba natin, we are now organizing. I will organize a team for this team to track him down.
Mimi, Bantag and Zulueta are being hunted for their alleged involvement in the killing of broadcaster Percy Balmabasa or Percy Lapid last October 3, 2022 and alleged middleman Cristito Villamor Palana. They are also wanted for torture complaints filed by inmates at the New Bilibid prisons in Muntinlupa. The NBI have offered 2 million pesos reward for any information that could lead to Bantag and 1 million pesos for Zulueta. No arrests have been made after the Department of Justice offered cash reward for their capture. Mimi.
Thank you very much, Jeff, for that update.